So we have made last week and weeks going forward three major changes to our modeling approach. These are, we believe, improvements, and then there will be further changes coming quite soon. So let me go through the major changes that have been implemented. First, we've taken on board a huge amount of new data on excess mortality. Most importantly, data from the civil registration systems in a number of states in India, which point out that the death toll related to the Delta surge was much larger than we previously thought. We have also improved the way we use statistical models to predict excess mortality in places where we don't have the direct measurement of excess mortality. We use many more covariates or predictors, and that has improved the robustness of the approach. The key finding there is that excess deaths related to the pandemic are close to 15 million in the world. And so if you think about roughly 5 million reported deaths and 15 million excess deaths, of course, the question is what fraction of those excess deaths are directly related to the virus and what are related to things related to the pandemic, but not the virus infecting particular individuals. So that's the second major change, which is an attempt to calculate that number. The actual data to do that is precise and available at the individual level is very limited. Some countries like the Russian Federation actually report all the COVID positive deaths, regardless of what it says on their death certificate. So that gives us some insights. In a place like the Russian Federation, about 65% of the deaths are directly related to COVID, and a third or more are related to other factors that are related to the pandemic, not directly to the virus. We have a few other countries where there have been data audits, like in Mexico on causes of death and in Peru, and then a handful of local jurisdictions in the U.S. and in Europe. Putting that all together and using some statistical approaches, we have tried to estimate the fraction of excess mortality that is directly COVID and then build that into our analysis around COVID. So when you see total COVID deaths now on our website or in our policy briefs, they used to be excess deaths, all excess deaths. Sort of the assumption was that all of those were directly related to COVID. And now we have this more nuanced approach where we're saying a fraction of the 15 million deaths are directly due to COVID. And that number is not 15 million, it's closer to 10.5 to 11 million. Now, the third major change is the way that we estimate past infections, which is a critical determinant of how much transmission is going on, often called R-effective. And then we use statistical models to find out what are the predictors of R-effective, like mask use or seasonality or mobility as examples. So it's really important the way we estimate past infections. We triangulate, as you may know, based on seroprevalence surveys, based on case reporting, based on hospitalizations, and based on deaths. And the major change we've done is we've added a much more extensive analysis of uncertainty, both in each of those factors, the seroprevalence, how fast do antibody tests wane over time, uncertainty in the estimate of the infection detection rate, which is what we use to go from cases to infections, or the infection hospitalization rate, or for that matter, the infection fatality rate. So multiple sources of uncertainty are being used. Now, in some countries with really consistent clear data or states in the U.S., this has made almost no change. But in a place where the data are less robust, we see really quite wide uncertainty in the fraction of the population that's been infected already, and therefore wide uncertainty in what has been past infections by day. And that's all being rolled into the model released last week and this week, and there's some description in the policy briefs for last week. Now, it's a good indication that we try to keep up with a fast-moving epidemic, and we are trying to constantly adapt our modeling framework to deal with the challenges that emerge. We are on perhaps the eighth version of our model during the course of the pandemic, if you count all the different subtleties and introduction of variants and then an immune escape variants and various ways of getting at past infection. And so, not surprisingly, interestingly, we will be moving in the next few weeks to a model that takes into account explicitly waning immunity and the matrix of relationships between immunity of infection with one variant, including the ancestral variants, and any other variant. And so that will allow us to better capture what we don't capture right now, which is that more and more people over time, if they don't get a booster, will become susceptible again to at least infection, even if they have some protection against severe disease and death. Lastly, to capture the fact that right now we're in this phase of the pandemic where it's important to try to stay ahead of developments like waning immunity, stay ahead of the complex combinations of vaccinations that different individuals are now starting to receive, stay ahead of the potential of new variants spreading, and take into account, for example, travel patterns and data on travel patterns. We will move to a cadence of putting out our updates every 2 weeks instead of every week, giving us more time in the intervening week to focus in on these model improvements and model developments.